want to talk about Thursday and about today and the lesson and about ascension. There's an old story that you probably may have heard. It may be true, but it has some truth in it. And it goes like this. Jesus, after his ascension, went up to heaven in the celestial place, was surrounded by angelic hosts who was singing, and he appears before his Father, and he comes to his Father, and his Father asked Jesus, what's next with the work that I sent you to do? What's the plan? Who's going to do it? And Jesus looks at him a little puzzled and says, Well, I don't know about any plan. No plan B? His Father says. No. Well, then what? All that you did, and all that you suffered, and all that you taught, what's going to happen with that? Jesus replied, well, I left everything I said, and everything I did, and everything I taught, in the hands of those men and women who followed me around during my earthly ministry. That's it? God said. Yep. Everything is up to them. Everything is up to them. Well, that's my rendition of the practical meaning of the ascension. Jesus is saying to the men and women who sacrificed everything to follow him, okay, now it's time for you to go to work. Get going on bringing in the kingdom by proclaiming the good news of the love that I taught you. Let's get going. Well, back to the ascension itself. There are four accounts of the ascension. There are three in the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, and Luke, and then the story in Acts. In Mark's Gospel, Jesus said, go into all the world and preach the gospel. In Matthew, Jesus says, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And lo, I am with you always to the end of the age. And then in Luke, Jesus blesses them and is parted from them, and they return to Jerusalem with great joy, continuing in the temple, praising God. Well, when we look at those four accounts of that pivotal event in Jesus' life and ministry, as reported by the Gospels and in Acts, I think there's a clear meaning to the early church and a clear meaning to us. First, it's a reminder of ourselves of this extraordinary event and what happened. One of my favorite New Testament writers and commentators is William Barclay, a Scottish Presbyterian from the last century. Here's what he says. The ascension must always remain a mystery, for it attempts to put into words what is beyond words and to describe what is beyond description. It was unthinkable that the appearance of Jesus should grow fewer and fewer until finally they petered out. That would have essentially wrecked the faith of men. There had to come a day of dividing when the Jesus of earth finally became the Christ of heaven. And when Jesus said, you shall be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth, and he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. Well, what's the meaning of all this for today? What do we make of this? Well, going back to my final comment in the introduction, this may sound a bit bit sacrilegious when I say this, but let me share with you what I think Jesus really was saying to us. I'm out of here. Now y'all go to work. It's that simple. Jesus left the earth, left everything he did in our hands. Well, in the hands of those first followers. And that has been passed on and passed on and passed on. And we are now recipients of that, and we must pass on the good news of Jesus. Get to work on my mission and ministry as I have taught you. You see, I think the church has a proclamation task. It is the duty of the church. And that, my friends, means it is the duty of every Christian, you and me, to tell people the story of the good news of Jesus Christ. And to those who have never heard it, there's an old model that I grew up with as a young person and as an early clergy person. And it's an old-fashioned idea that the preaching and the proclaiming was left up to the preacher, because that's what he was supposed to do. It was a he in those days, and he was supposed to do it. Well, we've come to discover that is erroneous. It is certainly not a model of the New Testament. We've come to discover historically, if preaching were left to the clergy, the church would have dried up in the first century. And it would have perished. It was because of men and women and young people like you all that the church has continued to grow. Our prayer book states very clearly in the catechism, when the question is asked, who are the ministers of the church? The ministers of the church are the laity, number one. And then, as I like to say, incidentally, bishops, priests, and deacons. An example of what I'm getting at. When H.M. Stanley had discovered David Livingstone in Central Africa a long time ago, and when he had spent some time with him, he said, if I had been with him any longer, I would have been compelled to be a Christian. And he never spoke to me about it at all. The sheer weight of the witness of the man's life was irresistible. And you may have heard the phrase that's been attributed to St. Francis. Preach the gospel. Preach the gospel with all power. And if you have to, use words. That's pretty telling. So another way to preach the gospel is to tell your story through your living, your individual living of your life and the life of your congregation. And this gets to be meddling a little bit on the preacher's part. How do you run your business? How do you treat your employees? How do you spend most of your time on yourself or on others? What is your attitude toward those who might be different from you? If you pray, what do you pray for? You pray mostly for me or for others? Well, again, going back to the meaning for today of what I believe that Jesus said to those disciples, I'm out of here, y'all get to work. A very concrete, practical way for us to proclaim, to tell the story, is so simple. It goes like this from my own life. There was a parishioner in a former parish, and he kept being nominated to the vestry. each time he was nominated, he was declared ineligible because he wasn't a member of the congregation. He wasn't a community. And people were frustrated about that. And it was a good guy. He came to church every Sunday. He pledged. He participated in different activities. Was always there. So I heard the story, and early on in my time, I made a call on him in his office. Just dropped in. He was one of many lawyers that I had in that congregation. That's a tough thing to have. But anyway, so I just said, Sandy, I'm starting a confirmation class next Sunday, and I would like to invite you to come and be a part of that. He said, well, yeah, I'd love to come. He said, you know, nobody's ever asked me or invited me to come to a confirmation class or join the church. First thing we need to do, my friends, is to invite. That's simple. If you get folks here, you know what you have to offer. As an Episcopalian, we have our worship, we have our welcoming and our hospitality and so many things that we do. You've got to get them here. And that's the responsibility of each and every one of you, not the clergy. They are to care for the flock. You are responsible for growing the flock. When I was in the parish ministry, I used to tell the congregation, you bring in the sheep and I'll share them. So, as Jesus said, in all seriousness,